Welcome back for episode 22 of the Astronomical Apocrypha, the Seleukid Empire narrative let's play for Rome II with Divideid Impera. Last time, the power structure of the Seleukid royal dynasty took a series of drastic turns, beginning with the death of Antiochos Soter at Alexandria in Arachosia. His grandson, Seleukos II, supported by the loyal Euclid, became the undisputed regent of the East, while his other grandson, Antiochos Hierax, was forced to temporarily suspend his march west to confront his father and the usurper queen Berenike by a huge Roman invasion force landing in Apollonia. Though pushed back to the town of Epidamnos, Hierax doubled back with his army to intercept and destroy the Romans, his royal swordsmen forcing apart the two legions while his Syrian war elephants were set loose into the infantry column of Legio VII. With the royal household in chaos thanks to the antics of Antiochos Theos and the recent death of Antiochos Soter, the stage was finally set for Cordelian to make a grab for power, although in a surprise he suddenly died of natural causes, succumbing to a fever aboard the flagship of his fleet, the Heralds of Triton. A sinister plot was nevertheless unfolding against the Emperor of the West, Antiochos Theos, as the decorated but rusty warrior king led his army in an ill-fated assault on the Insubres stronghold at Medlon, and the head of the once great and supposedly invincible demigod now decorates the gates of the city. Look up ahead, a Roman soldier, a centurion, probably an escapee from the massacre of Legio VII. Capture or kill? Neither. I'm expecting this one. Welcome, Spurious Titinius. Is your task complete?
For the most part. I planted the false information about the city defenses, and the Jewish levies were willing to turn their backs on your father for perceived past injustices. The temple to Zeus Ammon in Jerusalem being chief among their complaints. But yes, I won't keep you in suspense. Your father the king was killed as much by his own hubris as by my interventions.
Excellent. What do you mean, for the most part? What of that Egyptian harpy and her hatchling usurper?
She has fled south to Rome, where undoubtedly she spreads the word of my treachery. You have your throne before you now. But you've given the Senate the justification they need to restore Berenike and her son to power as their puppet rulers of the Seleukid territories.
Even so, Spurious, you have done well. In any event, we will mount an attack on Rome, and I will throw her child from the city walls myself if necessary. You will have your regency in Italia, and my mother will honor Eurydice's promise to you, stepfather. The destruction of Legio VI and Legio VII by Antiochos Hierax seems only to have inflamed the Roman desire to capture Apollonia. And immediately after entering the intern phase, Legio III embarks from Brundisium and sails directly for the formerly Epirote capital. Defending the city are Antigonos Doson and his small army, a badly damaged garrison, and Sanius, the admiral of a new navy I was beginning to build, but currently only the captain of his own ship, as I haven't had the opportunity to add any additional vessels to the fleet. The Romans are coming, presumably from the west, and I can only assume that the minimap has been rotated 90 degrees for some reason. Legio III will likely be suffering from seasickness, but the Roman legions feature the most elite and deadly troops in the game, and I'm quite sure we'll lose this battle, but I'm hoping I can inflict some damage on the enemy with my new Admiral Sinias before they land. Antigonos Doson was apparently expecting the Romans to make landfall to the south of the city, as he and his army are now making their way back to the settlement. As they do, Cineas commands the tiny garrison navy ships and their skeleton crews straight in to harass the advancing transports of Legio III, ordering his men to ram the weaker Roman ships but otherwise keep their distance and avoid hand-to-hand engagements. Approaching the Roman fleet of transports, Cineas and his men choose their targets. The weak assault the Ares, targeting regiments of Ala Legionaria and Pedites Extraordinarii on the left and right. The boat full of Ala Legionaria collapses upon the first impact, and sinking and taking the elite horsemen with it. Cineas's towered Pantares then crashes into the Ballista crew's transport, the impact bringing the ship's hull integrity to a mere 3%, barely but still seaworthy. The adjacent Pedites Extraordinarii suffer a similarly close call, with the other marine ship delivering a 98% damage blow to the hull of their craft. Meanwhile, the original Dares has become embroiled as the Romans come to their senses and toss grappling hooks over to ensnare our marines. And with the tiny crew now committed to melee, they don't last long against the elite Roman fighters. The other marine ships finish off the Pedites Extraordinarii before plowing into a ship full of legionaries, and sinking that one too. Cineas has also been caught by the Roman grappling hooks and finds himself fighting a unit of legionaries as more and more Roman ships move in to join the melee. His more heavily armed, full-strength units put up a bit more of a fight, but it's clear he won't be escaping. My last remaining melee ship hammers right into the side of another transport full of Pedites Extraordinarii, but as they find themselves under a withering hail of darts, their unit is wiped out before they can inflict the coup de grace. Now, as Antigonos Doson and his men reach the edge of town and prepare their defensive positions, I'm down to my little archer ship and her tiny but intrepid crew. We've managed to sink several Roman vessels, the little garrison fleet having done much more than its weight in damage, but I fear we won't be able to hold off the remainder of the Roman army, so dangerous are the infantry carried in the transports. But the archer ship isn't finished. I realize that the crew aren't doing much damage with the bows against the thick Roman armor and large shields, but the ship, in spite of its small size, still has the capability to deliver lethal ramming strikes on the enemy. The pursuit Trihemiola delivers its first blow, striking the already damaged Pedites Extraordinarii transport, then veering sharply to the left to deliver a pair of strikes to yet another Pedites transport, sinking that one too. Though they're pursued closely, they manage to extract themselves before the Roman grappling hooks can find a hold on their ship, swinging around in a wide arc and deftly outmaneuvering the two pursuing transports before bringing their prow to bear on the transport of Marcus Mamercus, the legionary commander. As they begin rowing full speed ahead, they clip the side of one of the pursuing vessels going the opposite direction, and the lucky strike tears a gaping hole in the Roman vessel, and now it too is taking on water. The subsequent strikes on the enemy general's ship destroys its hull, and soon their commander joins them in abandoning ship, although he's unable to shed his heavy armor and sinks rapidly into the depths. The Trihemiola then cruises at a cluster of enemy ships still entangled in the wreckage of Cineas's fallen towered Pantares, and though the Romans try to drag my archers into the mess, they manage to maneuver away at the last minute. Improbably, my archers continue their devastation of the enemy fleet, circling around and rowing for all their worth to smash another Legionarii transport, before slipping away from a huge transport full of Cohors Prima. However, a smaller and swifter vessel full of Roman Velites skirmishers at that instant managed to land a couple of grappling hooks into the pursuit Trihemiola, and the full-strength Roman regiment proves its superiority in melee, defeating my archers in combat and setting the hated craft ablaze before returning to their own vessel. There are now only four Roman regiments remaining, although even these four could be enough to destroy my large but weak garrison defense. However, it seems that only one ship, the large transport of 400 Cohors Prima, is free of the wreckage to make its landing on the beach. The ship is greeted by my archers, who manage to do significant but still not sufficient fire damage to completely sink the transport. As the men of the first cohort pile out of their craft, my archers retreat and the white shield pikemen brace themselves for a very difficult fight. The Cohors Prima are badly outnumbered, even taking into account their extraordinarily large unit size, and I prepare to surround them, although they push hard, battling in between the pikes and forcing their way through the ranks until they've pushed all the way into the center of my defenders, inflicting serious damage on a regiment of archers who begin falling back. Even as all of my available defenders pile into the melee, the Romans steady themselves and fight in their disciplined fashion, easily defeating my depleted militia units. Eventually, however, the protracted fight and the flanking and rear attacks take their toll, and the Roman numbers dwindle until they can no longer keep up with the fight. With the rest of the Romans stuck at sea in what appears to be a bug of some sort, my only option is to concede the battle or wait it out. I decide to wait, even though there are about 40 minutes remaining. Eventually, the timer runs completely out, with nothing further having happened in the interim, and we claim a hard-fought but almost completely lucky victory. Now, I doubt I could pull off this feat twice, so we'll count ourselves lucky to have suffered only 345 losses to the 1,744 elite Romans killed of Legio III Primogena. It's classed as a heroic victory, but the heroism is completely reserved for Cineas and the intrepid sailors of the garrison navy. Beaten but not destroyed, the Romans, having finally extricated themselves from the wreckage, flee back to Brundisium, while Apollonia remains in Seleukid hands. Unfortunately, this isn't the only unwelcome surprise of the intern phase, as the last gasp of the Katpatukan military makes a surprise assault on Eualcidas and the badly damaged Spear of Aries, who made an ill-advised auto-resolve assault after suffering severe siege attrition in their bid to capture Pantikapaion. Our enemy has mostly full-strength regiments, while many of ours are so weak they're nearly disbanded, but we do have many more regiments at our disposal and some tall walls to hide behind. If Eualcidas must meet his end, I'm sure he would prefer to die in battle, so we'll fight this one manually.
It has been an honor to march and fight with you. And though many gave their lives to claim this little outpost on the Black Sea, we still have foes before us. Traitorous Katpatukans, Neo-Bosphoran Greeks, and admirably brave but completely unreasonable Thracians. A medley of the vanquished return to haunt our success. We may die here, but their victory will be short-lived as Seleukos himself is coming north. And if we die, so much the better. I relish the thought of earning a hero's death. Would you rather die of infirmity, age, or treachery? These are deaths for women, not for Eualcidas or the Spear of Ares. Conan the Cimmerian, remind these men who will defend your homeland what is best in life.
The Katpatukans are approaching the peninsular city's landward wall, upon which I've interspersed archers and hoplite regiments while I put many deployables of the Spear of Ares at the interior side of each gate, and the cavalry gather at the right-hand gate. The Katpatukans first send up their three ladders driven by units of hired Bosphoran hoplite, as my cavalry circle around to the enemy flank to shadow the remainder of their force. None of the three ladders can be destroyed before they hit the wall, and my own weakened hoplite brace themselves for the defense as Eualcidas rushes his shield-bearers over to assist his men at the gate on the right side. Once all three ladders are in place, the rest of the Katpatukan force begin moving up, with their mounted general slightly behind the rest of their force. As Eualcidas and his hoplites battle those of the enemy, enough separation develops that my own extremely weak but still dangerous cavalry find an opening to lash out at the enemy general. With his bodyguard surrounded, the multiple charges prove to be too much for him, even taking into account the depleted state of my units. With the enemy general dead, Eualcidas sees a glimmer of hope, and the ferocity of his reprisal destroys the attackers at the right gate, and he hurriedly begins moving back to assist the men on the left, although now the Katpatukan swordsmen and skirmishers are nearly at the wall. My cavalry split off to destroy the Katpatukan skirmishers, and this draws the attention of the adjacent sword regiments who break off their assault on the wall to pursue my horsemen. Fortunately, this is just what our men need, as it gives Eualcidas the time he needs to drive back the Bosphoran hoplites from the wall. My citizen cavalry deliver more punishing strikes to the Thracian mercenaries, and the lightly armored and now winded infantry are easily felled by the Greek cavalry, who decimate one unit, pausing in their pursuit, to turn about and descend upon the other. The rapid loss of so many men proves to be a tipping point for the Katpatukan morale, and quite unexpectedly, the entire remainder of their army breaks and the battle is abruptly ended. Although the Thracian mercenary warriors seemed particularly poised to wreak havoc on our decimated garrison force, we actually managed to survive the battle with minimal losses, only losing 95 while approximately half the Katpatukans were casualties, including their general. Their survivors appear to escape, although it seems that without any actual Katpatukans among their number, the faction is eliminated, as we learn at the start of the following turn. There's also been some mischief by an Insubres champion on our few remaining men of Antiochos Theos' army, the Thunderbolts of Zeus. After a bit of political maneuvering, including several promotions, I reinstate Scylla's terror at Apollonia, recognizing the importance of a navy at this port after the battle last turn, and command is handed over to Kylon, with Kynaeus now deceased. I'm immediately starting to recruit some more marine ships for his navy, although it takes about half of our remaining wealth for the turn. After squandering a bit more money on agent actions and a new aqueduct at Bactria, I've spent the rest. Antiochos Hierax, Seleukos II, Antilochus, and Diogenes all continued their journeys, and I'm very quickly ready to let the season pass into spring. Although the intern sequence is relatively quiet this time, it's not entirely free of unpleasant surprises, as more Insubres agents show up at Patavium to cause trouble. Much worse, however, is the news of Eualcidas' death. Although he clearly lived a hard life, I was quite surprised to see him suffer a non-violent death before the age of 60. Eualcidas is replaced as commander of the Spear of Aries by the much less fiery and impetuous Hermocrates, a man known for his love of philosophy and common decency. I continue promoting my generals as much as possible, and Seleukos has quietly begun cementing support in the faction, bringing over members of the nobility who might support his brother should he make a bid for power. And this time I spend quite a bit of money greasing the palm of Dymas to ensure his loyalty. Denia continues scouting west, finally reaching Roman territory in Africa at the apparently undefended settlement of Euphrania. Eurydice, still confident after turning two Roman agents last episode, again tries her hand at coercion, this time against Faustus Lollius Messala, but she can't quite seem to replicate her prior success. Hierax continues his march west, now reaching the outskirts of Patavium, where a Volcae insurrection has taken place and the rebel army is raiding the countryside. I'm also bringing Pausanias into the Adriatic to combat Roman naval power, our enemies in the Phoenician Sea having already been extinguished. During the intern phase, there's a great deal of Roman troop movement, with Legio III seen briefly heading north along the Italian peninsula, and Roman fleets moving about the Mediterranean, but they don't seem to have rebuilt their military to the extent needed to mount another invasion across the Adriatic. Next turn, Eurydice tries again in her coerce attempt against the Roman governor, but still without success, and Denia continues her scouting expedition through northern Africa, still not encountering any Roman military force. Diogenes has reached Alexandria, but is not yet ready to push further west, pausing this season to recruit some interesting and cost-effective light Egyptian cavalry, slightly lighter than the Lancophori, but packing a bit more punch on the charge. The rest of the surplus goes into upgrading the Egyptian fields, as we're still slightly negative on food across the empire. Antiochos Hierax moves into Patavium to crush the Volcae Rebellion, and then up to the border with Medlon to prepare for his own assault on the barbarian stronghold. Though I thought previously that Sosicles completely eradicated the last vestiges of Pergamon, that seems to be not entirely the case, as a rebel army has risen up in the name of the original faction at the eponymous city. The rebel army really is composed of only weak and relatively untrained rabble, and our better equipped, disciplined, and more numerous Seleukid garrison is easily a match for them. Antiochos Hierax, along with his new Roman retainer Spurious Titinius, spots an opportunity at Medlon. There's a single general's retinue stationed outside the city, and Hierax knows that the barbarians are undisciplined and overconfident enough to meet his army in the field if he threatens one of their chieftains, so he marches out with the hawk's talons, not laying siege to the city but rather directly assaulting Lugatorix and his retinue, the glory of Epona. This does indeed bring out the garrison and its supporting army, and we do have an advantage on the balance bar, but again we're predicted to lose almost half of our army, even in the victory. Given the high quality of Antiochos' troops, I think we can do better, so we'll fight this one manually. The mountainous terrain of the region is making this an uneven battlefield with a moderate broad slope, with the high ground on the north side and the low ground in the forest in the south, while we're approaching from the east, near the road snaking through the northern end of the map. Almost all of the enemies will be coming on as reinforcements, so all we can see is Lugatorix deployed at the front of his own deployment zone. We'll cluster our forces on the north end of our zone to take advantage of the high ground and wait to see from where the garrison reinforcements arrive. I first begin moving my infantry around to face off against Lugatorix in a downhill fashion, but as they begin marching, the enemy reinforcements arrive at the northwestern end of the battlefield, already quite close to our own position, so I adjust our facing to accommodate to the new threat, lining up our pikes and shield bearers to greet the garrison as they assemble, Antiochos and his swordsmen in the rear, and my detachment of archers moving out wide to the left. Unfortunately, the enemy cavalry very quickly take advantage of the unprotected archers, launching themselves out of the clustered troops pouring onto the battlefield to ride down one of the Greek archer regiments. Dispatching a regiment of shield bearers saves the rest of the archers, but they're too late to save the doomed regiment, who are shattered in an instant. Lugatorix and his retinue are approaching from the south, harassed by javelins of our skirmish cavalry as they advance. The skirmish cavalry are forced to break away as the Insubres cavalry who ran down our archers come near, although they escape to a safe distance when the Syrian war elephants crash into Lugatorix's marching column, scattering the Batroas and crushing the enemy general almost immediately. The berserk elephants rapidly demolish the remnants of the general's retinue before rampaging into the adjacent Celtic cavalry, while the other Insubres cavalry regiment has already been dealt with quickly by my heavier citizen cavalry, who then ride toward the western wing with the large reinforcing army, which is composed primarily of sword-equipped infantry and skirmishers. Antiochos and his silver shields are now bogged down in a fierce fight against the remainder of the Insubres reinforcements, and the Celtic troops hold up remarkably well against the Seleukid elite swordsmen, while I have pikes and shield-bearers moving around toward the enemy rear. The citizen cavalry make a couple of quick strikes against the Insubres archers and swordsmen, but are quickly forced to retreat as their spear regiments come dangerously close to our men. I've regained control of the elephants, and move them in to take on the entire western enemy detachment, although they quickly become surrounded by spearmen, and in spite of the danger posed by the elephants, the spearmen hold the great beasts at bay, and now it's the elephants who are threatened as a few of them fall to the spears. Fortunately, this has more or less locked down the entire enemy line, while a single regiment of shield bearers, though breathless from charging around in their heavy armor, have managed to keep the Celtic local bows busy. The citizen cavalry are now free to strike at the enemy melee combatants at little danger to themselves, and though the balance bar is still even, I can see this turning in our favor very quickly. A citizen cavalry strike along with Antiochos' war shout is sufficient to break most of the enemies fighting his swordsmen, while two other regiments assist our beleaguered shield bearers on the left. Their work done, the first regiment shoots through the gap between the eastern and western enemy detachments to target the half of the Celtic bows not already occupied fighting my other shield bearer regiment. My elephants haven't even dropped to half strength, but as their berserk state fades and they come to their senses, the riders can't convince the animals to fight against the wall of bristling spears, and the elephants lumber away in panic. Likewise, one of my elite silver shield sword regiments has been beaten badly by the fierce Celtic warriors, and they too are falling back. Fortunately, already half the Insubres are already in retreat, so on balance we're still doing well, who have only lost three of our units. A massed volley of javelins from the Hippocondystae breaks the last Celtic spear regiment not engaged in the melee, and the Celtic bows have been scattered all over the battlefield in their attempt to escape from my cavalry and shield bearers. It's now just a matter of dispatching the cavalry to ride down the various isolated units, as Antiochos and his elite infantry mop up the remainder of those fighting in melee. And sure enough, as my elephants return from routing, the rest of the enemy break and retreat, as Antiochos spends a bit more effort running down those he can, in order to minimize resistance to his impending assault on the city. We earned a heroic victory, with nearly all of our units achieving huge kill counts in the range of 200 or more, the elephants topping the list at 590, but the light and heavy cavalry receiving similarly elevated counts of 486 and 487 respectively due to the work during the enemy rout. This drives what few men remain of the garrison back to the city, which is now almost devoid of meaningful resistance. The ensuing settlement assault is tantamount to an Insubres surrender, as we only lose 13 men in the auto-resolve. I go ahead and raise the settlement to give ourselves a blank slate upon which to work, Antiochos ordering his father's head taken down and replaced with that of the Insubres chieftain Lugatorix, although he doesn't send the remains back to Seleukia Imperia to be buried with those of Seleucus Nicator and Antiochos Soter, but rather puts them in a mass grave with the other soldiers. Eurydice still can't replicate her previous critical successes, and again fails against Faustus Messala. Danaia continues west across Africa, encountering some Garamantians, but as yet no Roman armies, and Diogenes follows behind her into Libya. The Romans seize upon the absence of Antiochos Hierax from Patavium as the reconstituted Legio III arrives with a sizable assault force to take the city from the Greek garrison and the remnants of the Thunderbolts of Zeus. Though our army is numerically superior, we do have the defensive deployables of the Thunderbolts, who could be in trouble here, as the balance bar indicates. I'm trying to set up an area filled with traps for the Romans to congregate in at the large wide-open gardens in the center of town just before the capture point at the square. I put some barricades to block the various entrances and slow the Roman advance, with our troops defending three avenues of approach, but most of them clustered at the capture point. At first, the Romans begin splitting their force apart, one group marching west and the other moving east, and I'm not sure if they'll take the route of attack that I want them to. My lone unit of citizen cavalry ride through the front of the city and spot their main infantry column marching in from the northern approach, so perhaps they'll still go the way I want them to. The smaller group is marching around the northwestern edge of the city, but eventually they too turn eastward, and it seems that the AI is going to take the path I want for the most part. Faustus Pollo, the new Legio III commander, and his cohorts Praetoria smartly stay behind the rest of his infantry to let them spring the traps and walk over the sharp spikes and stones as they make their advance into town. It's unfortunately that all of my missile troops are slingers, and I have no fire ammunition with which to light the brimstone pits. The Roman assault is furious, legionaries crashing into my wall of white shield pikes as Achaicus and his royal swordsmen fling the javelins overhead and then join the melee themselves. And on the opposing side, Faustus Pollo also wades into the fighting. There's a group of Roman skirmishers at the rear of their attack formation, which I would like to take care of with my citizen cavalry, but blocking my approach are a pair of superior Owl Legionaria units. One of the two Roman cavalry regiments spots my horsemen, and by then it's too late to escape. I have to charge my own men to meet theirs. The impact is terrible, and we get the worst of it, our numbers of horsemen dropping to half strength in the blink of an eye, while the Owl Legionaria seem to suffer no damage whatsoever. This does, however, pin them in place for the moment, and I have a couple of free hoplite regiments around the eastern edge of town and begin moving them up to take advantage of the Roman cavalry immobility. My horsemen waver but hold their ground long enough for the hoplites to hack through the barricades that were originally intended to protect them. And then, just as the citizen cavalry break, the hoplites arrive to surround and destroy the Owl Legionaria. The citizen cavalry, now at approximately one quarter strength, reach the eastern edge of town before rallying and then riding back toward the fight. My white shields and royal swordsmen are holding the line for now, but my slingers can't seem to get a reliable line of sight to hit the Romans with their sling stones. The free hoplitae approach their enemy rear where they engage the Marian legionary javelinmen, and shortly thereafter the citizen cavalry arrive to add their charge to the weight of the combat on our side. The Marian legionaries hold up remarkably well for skirmishers, and stubbornly refuse to break even though they're slowly, inevitably losing the combat. Part of this is probably because the hoplitae have such weak offensive statistics, and the horsemen are already tired and demoralized. In the meantime, my Ligurian detachment at the Western Avenue is starting to fail before the two-pronged Roman onslaught, and many of its regiments are already near half-strength, and one is already falling back. Finally, the Antisignani Marian legionary skirmishers break, and my hoplitae assemble to prepare for a rear attack on the Roman infantry. Even supported by the scant remaining citizen cavalry, their charge is anemic at best, although the ripple of panic from being assaulted in the rear does break the remaining Owl Legionaria cavalry and causes a couple of other units to waver. My citizen cavalry charge to and fro, bouncing from one unit to another, trying to keep the damage going, but soon they're driven off, as are another of my levy spearmen at the western entrance. The Romans have finally come to their senses and turned around a couple of units to fight directly with the hoplitae, and they dismantle our outclassed Greek-style infantry with professional efficiency. With the Illyrian and Ligurian levies struggling to hold back the tide at the western entrance, and the white shield pikes at half strength and dangerously close to wavering, things are looking grim. But then they get a little bit worse, as Achaicus, my defending general, is seen wading deep in the Roman lines, and in his zeal to defend the city has gotten himself surrounded, and it looks as if he could be killed at any moment. Looking for any opportunity to salvage the rapidly deteriorating situation, I decide to try a flanking attack by my Jewish slingers, men who have been through a tremendous amount of combat and live to tell the tale. On the western side, the Romans have broken through now and are chasing down my fleeing Ligurian garrison slingers. These men with their thick armor and broad shields, what can we do against such men? Great wealth and prosperity will come to him that can slay such a man. The kingdom of Israel will be exempted from taxes. This is what will be done for the men who can defeat this enemy. Have we come so far and left our sheep in the wilderness just to watch the battle in conceit? No. When a lion or bear carried off one of our flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I grabbed it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the bear and the lion will rescue me from the talons of the eagle. My Jewish slingers assemble at the edge of the gardens in the enemy rear, and with their pouches of slingstones still mostly full, they begin pouring a torrent of stones into the enemy rear. The stones are even more effective than I had imagined, quickly breaking a weakened unit of cohors prima, with my rallied hoplitae seizing on the opportunity to slaughter the fleeing men. More and more hurled stones batter the Roman formation as numbers both friendly and hostile dwindle in the prolonged fighting at the capture point. We're now down to just my general's bodyguard, the white shields, a handful of hoplitae, and some town mob remaining, but the slingers just keep throwing as if their lives depended on it, ignoring the fatigue in their arms. Tragically, Achaicus can no longer sustain himself and falls to a Roman gladius, but our own men fight on, and I'm astounded to hear that the odds are starting to turn in our favor in spite of the loss of our general. My slingers are now down to about a quarter of their ammunition, and I only have half-strength white shield pikes and hoplitae remaining to fight in close quarters, so things could go either way. But just then there's a flicker of hope as the enemy infantry cluster begins wavering almost in unison, and then as one the remainder of the enemy army breaks, my Jewish slingers dropping their slings to join the pursuit in melee. The Romans are difficult to bring down, even when fleeing due to their heavy armor, but we manage to catch Faustus Pollo before he escapes. This was a close and unexpected victory thanks to our stalwart pikemen and the timely involvement of the Jewish slingers, who between them scored over 1,300 kills. The damage done in the enemy retreat seems to have been sufficient to completely destroy Legio III, who are disbanded without their general, while the loss of our own general was really the only negative part of the battle outcome for us. Achaicus indeed earned an honorable death in the defense of Patavium, and I have to select a suitable candidate to lead the Thunderbolts of Zeus, whose most famous and only extant members are a group of veteran Jewish slingers. I wind up picking Dymas, a local man from the Levant, although not Jewish himself, to oversee the reconstruction of the city and the army. Antiochos Hierax destroys the remainder of the Insubres military, and with it the faction is obliterated. I have a fairly spectacular amount of wealth to spend this turn, and our income is flowing nicely, but I'm going to get a little bit more of a boost by reaching a trade agreement with the Raedi to the north of Medlon, who want no part of Antiochos Hierax's brutality. In addition to the agreement, we net 6,000 talents in a non-aggression pact, and while I seek similar agreements with the Nori and the Helvetii, they aren't as accommodating. Nearly half of this vast wealth is utilized to start the construction of a Tier 3 slave market at Bithynia et Pontus at Nicomedia, to further facilitate the flow of slaves from the north and west into Asia Minor, while most of the rest is spent on yet another slave market conversion at Marib, and an upgrade to the trained slave center at Eudaimon. Antiochos Hierax has taken up a strong position now in the foothills of the Ligurian Alps, having previously obliterated Legio VI and Legio VII, while Legio III has been twice rebuffed from settlement assaults at Apollonia and Patavium, and now they too have been annihilated, leaving the way into central Italy and Rome tantalizingly open, as the young Seleukid prince, advised by his mother Laodike and the Roman defector Spurious Titinius, prepares to try to take Rome by force, and at the same time eliminate the threat to his inheritance. The usurper queen Berenike and her young son Antiochos, who have fled to the Eternal City, and now enjoy the protection of the Roman Senate.